You probably already know that filled materials like carbon fiber filament can wear down your 3D printer's nozzle in no time. There are a couple of other materials that have similar effects that you might not be aware of. In today's video, I've tested the wear behavior of brass nozzles and the effect on print quality, as well as how you can spot if your nozzle is worn. So let's find out more. Guten Tag everybody, I'm Stefan and welcome to CNC Kitchen. I never really worried much about nozzle wear because I rarely printed abrasive materials, and when I did, I switched my nozzle for a hardened steel one. One day I noticed, after I inspected my changed nozzle a bit more closely, that it showed severe marks of wear, even though the only thing I printed before was just standard materials, but probably for more than 1,000 hours. At this point, I ask myself where this abrasion is coming from and what influence it has on the print quality of my parts. So what we will be doing in this video is simulating the nozzle wear with different sized nozzles. Then we'll print abrasive materials with new brass nozzles and see how they actually wear and check the influence of this wear in the print quality. We'll also take a close look at the nozzles with imprints using cold pulls, and I've also cut a couple of them open to see how they look on the inside. So make sure that you stay until the end. A lot of interesting investigations to look forward to. Before we start with the investigations, some words on nozzles and abrasive filaments. Nowadays, most of our 3D printer nozzles are machined from brass. Due to its ease of machining and very good thermal properties, it's an ideal material for this application, with an important downside. Brass isn't the hardest material and has the tendency to wear over time. For most of the materials we print with, this isn't an issue. PLA, PETG, ABS and so on are not really abrasive by themselves, and you can print many hundreds of hours and probably a dozen kilos and don't see anything at all. Though these polymers get more and more abrasive depending on what they are mixed with, and this already starts with the pigments. White materials, for example, can contain titanium dioxide, which is a very common white pigment, but just as in your toothpaste that also contains it, this ingredient can increase the wear during printing. It gets really bad with glow-in-the-dark filaments because the strontium aluminate that is used as the component that glows in the dark can chew away a brass nozzle only after a couple of hundred grams of material. I found a thread on Reddit where a user has collected some experiences. Take a look at them. Next, we come to the materials probably most are aware of, and these are the fiber-filled ones. Carbon fiber or even glass fiber reinforced materials can chew away a nozzle in no time, and this is actually something we'll test later. Also, be aware of wood filaments, because these fibers can also cause an early death of your shining nozzle. The same is also true for metal filaments. I also learned that standard materials can be mixed with other things to improve properties like warping and can also lead to more wear. When I started with this project idea, I thought that nozzle wear will primarily increase the diameter of the orifice. In order to simulate that, I sliced a 3D benchy with a normal 0.4mm profile in Prusa slicer and then printed always the same file with nozzles starting from 0.4mm all the way up to 0.8mm to see the effect on print quality. Just because I was curious, I also printed the same G-code with a 0.25mm nozzle. So first things first, all parts printed and finished, which is already something. Our baseline 3D benchy, printed with a suitable 0.4mm nozzle, came out very nice besides a bit of stringiness. The first thing that was notable was that the amount of stringiness increased the bigger the nozzle diameter got. At 0.6mm, we can also see a significant number of holes forming in the outer shell of the parts, and 0.8mm already looks quite nasty. We also are able to see that details slowly get lost and overhangs become worse. Interestingly, the part printed with a small 0.25mm nozzle looks even cleaner, was without strings, and I might be doing some more tests in the future if that could be a way to improve printing quality and, due to the higher line width, might improve the adhesion of the layers. though you have to be aware that smaller nozzles have a higher tendency to clog. So we have seen that a worn out orifice diameter can be noticed in decreased printing quality. So maybe take a closer look at your nozzle when you notice some weird change in your printing quality. The cold pull method I use to measure a nozzle diameter will be covered later. This was the simulated worn out nozzle test, but how fast and in which way do nozzles really wear? In order to find that out, I bought a bag of cheap Chinese nozzles that I will sacrifice for science. In hindsight, it probably would have been better to use a genuine, good quality E3D nozzle, but I didn't have anything else at that point. I don't want to say that all cheap nozzles are that bad, but there is a higher chance that you get what you actually paid for. I'll test two different materials, dust filament, glow-in-the-dark PLA, and some leftover Colorfab XTCF20, which is carbon fiber PETG. For each material, I'll first print a 3D Banshee with some regular PLA, then print a block of the abrasive filament, and print another 3D Banshee to see if the print quality changed. I'll try to judge the nozzle wear with some close-up pictures that I took with my macro lens and do a cold pull to measure the diameter of the orifice. This is actually a really cool method, though violently looking, to get a perfect imprint of the internals of your nozzle. I'm usually using very dry PLA filament because if you get bubbles, the result will be unusable. I heat the nozzle up to 180 degrees Celsius, feed a couple of millimeters of the material, and let it cool down to below 40 degrees Celsius. I disengage the extruder gears so that they don't imprint on the surface. I carefully remove the leftover material that used out during the nozzle cooling. Then I heat it up again, and as soon as it reaches 65 degrees Celsius, I pull hard on the filament while supporting the print head. As easy as it sounds, I wouldn't recommend this method to everyone, since if the temperature is only slightly off, you can really horribly block your filament path. That already happened several times to me, and taking the whole hot end apart isn't something for everyone. The imprint can then be used to judge the surface finish and even to measure the nozzle diameter. Make sure before you measure that you don't accidentally measure the chamfered part and get values that are too high. The glow-in-the-dark material was spectacular to print, especially when you turn off the lights, but the wear I had been expecting from the Reddit post was really underwhelming. After 330 grams of material, there was more or less no wear detectable. The cold pull still showed the same nozzle diameter as in the beginning. Maybe the edges were a tiny bit rounded, but nothing really serious. Much more interesting was to see how the internal surface finish of the cheap nozzle looked like. There was actually a spiral pattern in all of the cheap nozzles from the drilling procedure, which we'll see in more details in the cut-ups later. The thing is that if you ask me to machine a pattern like this, I wouldn't even know how to do it. So if you have a clue how to make this, then let me know in the comments. Also, our 3D Banshee looked like the control. So there's obviously a difference in glow-in-the-dark filaments, and some wear more than others. I checked back with this filament, and they confirmed that they do use strontium aluminate, but maybe particle size and shape might play a role there. By the way, if you find these kind of videos and investigations helpful, make sure that you're subscribed to the channel and have selected the bell to not miss any upcoming videos. Next, we'll get to the more interesting material, and that is the carbon fiber filled PETG. It was hurting me a bit on the inside to just print blocks of this plastic with it, but hey, it's for science. The blocks were really just 100% infill boxes to get the material as fast as possible through the nozzle. The results were very interesting for me because I noticed that the diameter of the orifice wasn't really changing during the tests. What I was able to spot though was that the tip was horribly wearing. This wasn't only visible on the macro shots, but I also noticed that the first layer thickness increased over time during the nozzle becoming shorter and shorter. Also, the abrasive carbon fibers rounded off all of the edges, which is a very clear sign that something is wrong. The pattern you can see on the nozzle is due to the fact that with my generic test parts, the print head is only moving in X and Y direction and plus and minus 45 degrees. After 360 grams of material, my leftover filament was gone, and the same goes for the nozzle. Interestingly, the print quality wasn't impacted as much as I would have thought. There is a definite increase of stringiness, you can also spot holes on the parts, overhangs don't look remarkably good, and some details are gone, but not as bad as for the 0.8mm nozzle. The thing is that if I would have gone further with this test, I would have at some point started to wear it down to the point where the internal chamfer starts, and this will increase the orifice drastically with every bit more of wear until you get to the point where your filament can pass right through the nozzle orifice. Now let's really take a look at the inside of some nozzles to find out how their internal geometry looks like and which wear marks we can see. For this, I've screwed the nozzles one by one into an old heater block and mounted that in my small vise on my Go CNC Next 3D CNC router. I mounted it on the right side so that the cutting forces won't unscrew the nozzle from the block. I used a 6mm 4-flute carbide end mill that I mostly buy from Banggood and that are really good, to be honest. A link to those is in the description, by the way. I moved the nozzle to its zero position with my newly added gamepad controller. I programmed a short cycle where I face mill the brass part at 500mm a minute at 25,000 RPM spindle speed. In each cycle, I removed half of a millimeter of material until half of the nozzle was gone. I did my best to deburr the edges with an X-Acto knife and polished the machine surfaces with a sharpening stone. The cut-up of the cheap Chinese nozzle confirmed the rough spiral pattern I still can't explain how they even managed to machine. If you also take a look at the nozzle that was tortured with glow-in-the-dark filament, there isn't much of a change besides the color change on the inside. The interesting part is the one I printed carbon fiber filament with. Here, the tip is almost worn away and very rounded off. The orifice is only slightly enlarged and the wear in the diameter is not that high. But probably only a couple of 100 grams of more material and it would have completely destroyed itself. I still think this is a very interesting sectional cut. Out of curiosity, I also murdered a brand new E3D V6 nozzle where we have a great internal surface finish. Besides that, there are two major differences that I noticed, and that is that the E3D nozzle uses a point angle of 60 degrees instead of 90 degrees that the knockoff has, which is probably beneficial for the flow behavior. Much more importantly is probably the tip itself, or better, the end of the nozzle bore. The ones I've tested were slightly chamfered, whereas the E3D nozzle shows a sharp transition. The interesting thing is, and this is, I promise, no marketing shenanigan, that with the E3D nozzle our Banshee is free of stringing, with the Chinese nozzle it's not. I'm quite sure that the internal surface finish only plays a minor role in print quality and more the point where the molten material leaves the nozzle. I'm not sure why this is the case, but I could imagine that having a chamfer on the edge causes the nozzle to act like a bigger one, and we know what the result of that is. Another possibility could be that the nice laminarly flowing molten plastic gets a way better flow separation at the edge than it does with a rounded or a chamfered one. What do you guys think? The reason why we probably see the chamfer on the cheap nozzle is that this is an easy way to remove the burr from drilling. Interestingly, my worn-out E3D nozzle I talked about in the beginning shows kind of a similar geometry, where the once sharp edge was rounded by wear, degenerating the print quality slightly. So, does this actually invalidate my results, since I didn't start with ideal conditions? I think maybe and no. Maybe because the initial stringiness was already due to a low quality nozzle, and therefore I can't tell at which point a good nozzle would have started with this behavior. But also no, because this is just an initial small problem, and printing quality only starts to really degenerate when there is way more wear. One of the main points also was to understand how the nozzles wear, how bad that is, and how we can check for it. But what do you think? What should I have done differently? And what would be something for a future test? Let me know your comments down below. But now to sum this all up. Brass nozzles do wear. The speed is depending on the material you print with. Rather than the diameter of the nozzle, the tip will primarily wear at first, until we reach the inner tapered section, and the wear of the tip results in an increased nozzle diameter. If the nozzles only wear slightly, and even the nozzle diameter increases, there is a change in print quality visible, though not as bad as I thought, and most significantly, we can see that in the amount of stringiness. If you want to check your nozzle for wear, take a look at the tip first, and see if material is missing, and if you can see rounded edges. If you want to buy cheap nozzles, make sure that they are not chamfered. If you don't want to risk that, buy genuine E3D nozzles, or from some other reputable manufacturer. For not worrying about nozzle wear, get yourself a wear-resistant nozzle, be it a hardened steel, ruby, tungsten carbide or whatever, and this will be something I'm actually planning to test in one of the next videos, so stay tuned for that.
Thank you very much for watching this rather long video. I hope it was worth your time and you have learned something. If you did, then leave a like and make sure that you're subscribed and have selected the bell. If you want to support me, then consider becoming a patron or help me out in other ways. Check out my other videos where I also did very interesting investigations. I hope to see you guys in the next one. Auf Wiedersehen and until next time.